wasn't until I had gotten into graduate school that I realized I had traded important pieces of myself to be successful. I was sitting across from one of my professors talking in her office. She wanted to know how I was doing as I wrapped up my first year. And I told her, honestly, I'm struggling. I told her I'd noticed how each of my professors had treated me as if I had done something wrong in class. She laughed. I told her I had noticed how I'd been snapped at for participating in discussions. And I wasn't being ridiculed, I was blatantly ignored when I raised my hand. I told her about the look of disgust I got when I was finally given permission to engage my peers. She said, "Not me though, right?" And then she laughed. So I told her personal struggles. I told her that I didn't know if my family was safe or if my mother would pass away, or if I could manage this new level of depression that had seemingly set in since I began school. I told her of issues with my supervisor. I told her I couldn't be myself in my program without being treated like a criminal, and I couldn't sit quiet and disengaged like the other white students in class without being accused of slacking off. And again, she laughed. And at this point, I could feel the tears of frustration building in my eyes. I remember clutching my coat in my lap so hard as if it would cover up the anger and embarrassment that I was feeling. Each expression of vulnerability, each call for help treated like a bad joke, one you laugh at out of pity, not because it's funny. And then it hit me. She had not heard me. She had not heard me because she had not allowed the context in which I was speaking to inform the way she listened. First generation college student, black and male from Chicago. She saw just another graduate student who maybe was having some troubles in graduate school. I told this story at an important moment for me. I had this monumentous goal of giving a TED talk one day, and last week I was able to achieve it when I spoke at TEDx Iowa State University. And I stood up and I spoke. And I told the world one more time that talking about race is important. I told them about my story here. My voice adding to the litany of heroes and heroines of color who lived the experiences show that this is true. I added academic work just to further the legacy of truth that I stood on, quoting top black male scholar Dr. Sean Harper, when he said, numerous researchers have called attention to the underrepresentation, social isolation, cultural incongruence, and racism that black students face on predominantly white campuses. I added some 1903 W.E.B. Du Bois, who describes how we react to such disparities. He calls it a peculiar sensation, this double consciousness. This idea of looking at oneself through the eyes of others, of measuring one's soul by the tape of a world who looks on in amused contempt and pity. One ever feels his two-ness, an American, a Negro. Two thoughts, two souls, two unreconciled struggles in one dark body. See, their stories, their voices made mine feel more powerful. I bravely shared about my pathway to education and how I had to grow up believing that somehow being educated would make me more equal to white people in this country, only to have the weight of my own experiences crush that truth. That when I got to universities, I was treated differently. And not just something mildly noticeable, but I was actually treated far worse than the other students. And I shared how I shamefully code switched to avoid the persecution of microaggressions and subtle racism. Yet my truth showed me that sacrificing your cultural identity to assimilate is cultural suicide. Let's take a moment and think about this. cultural suicide, self-harm that is fatal to part of who we are, a part of us that we cannot afford to give up, a part of us we do not have to give up in order to be successful. And as I look at the cultures and beautiful people of color in this room tonight, I'm reminded of the people who kept me from the sunken place of cultural suicide. People like my sister, who encouraged me in ways that only a black woman could. I think about the beautiful people of color in my graduate program, who I lean on daily, and I hope to lean on after I graduate. I think about the Multicultural Student Affairs Office staff, who have supported me in ways that I couldn't begin to describe. People who reminded me that the beauty I hold as a person of color often makes me feel like a rose who grew out of the concrete. And it is through that recollection that I'm here to remind those of you who have forgotten and those of you who are unsure that it is okay to be yourself. We are a community who share the responsibility of putting humanity before biases. It is okay to express your cultural identity whatever way you see fit. You don't have to fit any molds to fit in. You don't have to fit any molds to be successful. We are not isolation spots of beauty in urban and suburban areas. We are not just a flower who grew from the concrete. We are gardens of opportunity, full forests of potential. Give yourself that warm reminder today and consider your forest reclaimed.